All right, good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming. My name is Chris Stecker. I'm the horticulture technician and Master Gardener Program Coordinator for Alamance County Extension. And today we're going to give you some secrets to our plant sale. We're going to teach you a little perennial math. So we call it multiplying by dividing. Okay, there are many ways to propagate plants. One of them is sexual propagation, which involves exchange of genetic material and produces seeds. We're not going to talk about that today. Asexual vegetative propagation includes cloning, and you can do this by cuttings, layering, or division. Perennials, as you know or may not know, is that they're called perennials because they live more than 2 years. There's some are short-lived perennials, don't live much more than 2 years, and some are long-lived perennials and live quite a bit longer than 2 years. There are woody perennials. This is a chaste tree. That's what we would call a woody perennial. And herbaceous perennials, daylilies. Herbaceous means that every year the leaves die down and then they come back again in the spring. Okay, why would you want to divide plants? Well, sometimes they just get too big and you might want to divide them to keep them under control size-wise. You also might want to rejuvenate a plant. Sometimes if they've stopped flowering as much as you would think they would, such as if your daffodils kind of slow down or your iris slow down with blooming and they're not blooming so much even though they're getting enough sun, you might want to divide them then. If there are dead areas, this happens a lot of times with asters where the center part is just kind of gone and it's around the outside, it's still okay. Then you might want to divide it and discard the center part. If there's sparse bottom foliage because it's so crowded, that you might want to divide it then. And some plants you really never do need to divide unless you want to multiply. This hosta is a good example of a plant that really never does need to be divided, but it's so satisfying to get more. So when to divide? Okay, this is a rule of thumb, and did everybody get the handout?
Yes.
Okay, this is a really good handout. This is from Clemson University, which is another land-grant university in South Carolina, but it has really good instructions about dividing perennials. The rule of thumb is to divide spring-blooming perennials in the fall and fall-blooming perennials in the spring. For fall division, you would do that early fall, September and October, and allow at least 4 to 6 weeks before the ground freezes. Now, the ground isn't going to freeze until well after the first frost. Spring division, do this ideally as soon as growing tips emerge. And never divide perennials on a hot, sunny day. So you really don't want to do it in midsummer. Now, I say this is a rule of thumb, but it is flexible. Okay, when you get ready to divide your plants, you want to water thoroughly, make sure everything's hydrated, and then prepare the area where you want to put the plants. Now, if that's going to be in a pot, you want to have, if you want to pot the divisions, you want to have your soil ready and your pots ready. And you want to have the area in the ground dug, a hole dug. Any amendments you're going to put in the soil, you want those mixed in so you can take the plant out, divide it, and put it in its new home. Prune the stems and foliage to 6 to 8 inches to reduce moisture loss. This is not something you would do if you have a lot of new early growth coming out. You wouldn't cut that if it's just growth tips, but if it's leaves, because you're gonna be cutting the roots, so you wanna reduce the amount of top foliage to take some of the stress off. Don't cut off all the leaves, but cut back some of the leaves. Use a sharp shovel or a spading fork. And you want to cut deeply in all around the plant to do the drip line about 4 to 6 inches away from the crown, and then pry with the tool and lift the whole clump to be divided. So for this, you want to use a tool that has a deep blade on it. And I'm going to show this shovel here. It's my new shovel. Mark likes the name. It's called Wolverine. But you see how long this blade is and sharp. And this last little foot pad here, so you can step on it and put. Actually, it's so tall that I might fall off if I'm not well balanced on it. But anyway, this is the kind of shovel that you would want to use for that. Okay, so if the clump is too large to lift, as we discovered with some of our perennials that we were dividing, you might want to cut it in sections. So you find a likely space in the clump that looks like you can divide it there. And then again, use the shovel and just cut down in there and divide it into more than one piece. Because sometimes two people can't lift 200 pounds of soil out of a hole. Okay, you want to take off as much soil as possible from the roots. Take any dead leaves or stems off. And perennials do have several different types of root systems, and each one needs to be treated a bit differently. There's spreading, clumping, rhizomatous, tuberous, and bulbs. So the spreading root system has a lot of matted roots, and this you'll see this in especially in something like lamb's ears, because they kind of crawl along the ground. The roots are pretty shallow, and they're really a good candidate for just taking off a piece of it, and then moving it somewhere else if you just want more plants. But if you want to rejuvenate the original plant, because it has a tendency to die in the center, you dig up the whole thing and then just plant some of the outside parts. They can crowd out their own centers, and that happens a lot with these plants. Asters are notorious for that. So you can pull them apart by hand easily, or you can cut with a shears or knife. So here's lamb's ears being pulled apart easily by hand, and here we're using on a Stokes aster, we're using a knife. Okay, and then you want to replant the divisions at the same level that they were previously growing. The clumping root system has lots of fleshy roots that originate from a central clump, and there are multiple growing points. This is often necessary to cut through the crowns with a heavy, sharp, or serrated knife, and this is, again, a good tool. Looks a little bit like a weapon. It's a good thing to have in the garden if you're in a questionable neighborhood. But this serrated edge here is excellent for cutting apart clumpy roots. And then this is good for weeding, but it has a little tip garnet. It's very pointy. So this is a good tool for dividing. It's often necessary. At large clumps, you might need to pry apart with back-to-back spading forks, and we'll demonstrate that. Or Sharon Yarborough, my assistant master gardener today, will definitely show that. And then on each division, you want to keep at least three developing eyes or fans, which we call parts of a daylily, together. And you can do this with hostas, daylilies, astilbes, and many ornamental grasses. So here's doing a hosta that has the leaves out. Now, if your hosta comes out this much, you have to be very careful with the leaves, because if you destroy the leaves, they don't come back. I mean, the plant will live, but it'll be ugly for the year. So you just have to be gentle with it. Take it out and carefully, you can use a hose spray to rinse off. And this will show you more the growing, where the areas are, where they're coming out of the ground, so you can see easily where to use your knife and cut it apart. And here's another one that's already cut. And here's the spading fork method. You just put the two spading forks in back to back and pry them apart, and voila. Right, rhizomatous, I had to look up how to pronounce that. By the way, Google how to pronounce a word, and it's there. Rhizomes are stems that grow horizontally at or above the soil level, and you can see it in a clump of iris. If you look down, you can see that the rhizomes are on top of the ground, basically. And bearded iris are the most common rhizomatous perennial. So you want to cut and discard rhizome sections that are 1 year or older, and any that are diseased or damaged. Each division should include a few inches of healthy rhizome and one fan of leaves. So here's how you do it. I'm cutting back the leaves here. And this is generally something that's done in right after it's done blooming. However, iris are very resilient and will come back even if you're doing it this time of year. So this is the fan. You can see here it's got this is the old the mother bulb or the mother rhizome, and then these are the offshoots. So that's an illustration from your handout, and it shows this is the original plant. And so you're going to discard that part. So here's one of the divisions. You see these really, really long roots? It's okay to trim those. So you want to replant it so that it's actually above the ground. You can put a little bit of soil on it, and you've reduced the weight now by cutting back the leaves. This one didn't have a lot of leaves on it, so it's why it's not cut. But you can reduce the weight and keep it from tipping over by cutting back the leaves to about 6 inches. And these roots are too long.
So cut them off?
Yep. This is how they were cut off here. Okay, tuberous roots. Dahlias are an example of perennials with tuberous roots. You want to cut the tubers apart with a sharp knife. Dahlias should be lifted in the fall, and you can either replant them then if they're hardy where you are, or actually they can be dug up in the spring and also replanted in the spring if they survived the winter. Dahlias are what they call not reliably hardy here. So if it's your prize dahlia that you won an award at the state fair with, you might want to lift it in the fall and save it till spring. So you want a piece of the original stem and a growth bud attached, and then after division, replant or store the tubers for spring planting. So here we have I almost dug our dahlia in the garden here, but I was afraid to, so I left it. But this is what it would look like if you did, because it was spring and I wasn't sure if it was going to come back. And here what you do is you dig, you break off or you cut off part of this stem that has this tuber attached to it, to divide it. Bulbs. Okay, dig entire clumps as you do for other perennials, and then you divide the spring flowering bulbs, which are daffodils, crocus, in late spring after the foliage dies down. And then you divide summer flowering bulbs such as crinum lilies, hymenocallis, and Asiatic lilies in early spring just as new growth begins. Remove the excess soil from the clump. Carefully pull the small bulbs from the base of the plant. Check the original bulb for firmness. And if it looks good, if it's still healthy, you can replant it. And if it's shriveled or damaged, toss it. Now, bulbs, you can, yes?
I planted daffodils this past November. It was like after Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
They're up out of the ground, but they're not blooming. Did I put them in too late?
No, it should have been okay.
There were yellow daffodils. I got
It may still bloom this year, and if not, don't worry about it. Just don't do anything to the leaves, and it will definitely bloom next year, as long as they're doing well. If you want to store your bulbs for future planting, be sure to remove all the soil and allow the bulbs to air dry for several days. Remove any injured or diseased bulbs and any that feel soft. Store in a well-ventilated, this is how much it has to be ventilated, double ventilated. Cool, dark spot, and check periodically to make sure they are not rotting or drying out. Generally, your refrigerator is probably the right temperature if you don't mind having a lot of bulbs in your refrigerator. Yes?
You just put them in the drawer. You don't have to wrap them in newspaper or anything.
Well, it depends if you have one of those dehumidified drawers, because you really don't want it to be that you don't want to be moist. So, yeah, if you've got a cellar, that's a good place to put them. Not a lot. Yeah, keep them apart so they are well ventilated.
If they're dried out, do you just toss them?
If they're shriveled, yes, I would just throw them. And check them periodically to make sure that some of them are not going that way. Yes.
Not treat the hyacinths the same way.
Yes. Okay, here's some bulbs. This is a This is, thank you, Mark, for your assistance. I'm going to show this little video now. Hopefully I can do it, thanks to the help of Scott. yeah, let's see. Alt-tab. And. Okay. So here is a little video about crinums, which will give you an idea. So go back up.
We are in Beech Island, South Carolina, near Oregon, visiting the family farm of Jinx Farmer.
So sorry. Hey, almost got it right. So here, we decided we were going to dig our crinum, which has been in the ground for 7 years. I did the math on that. And here, Mark and I used 2 shovels, and I helped. And we dug a circle around it. And we did something that Jenks and his 3 guys didn't do. We decided that the 200-pound root ball, it wasn't coming out of the ground, even with the two of our strong arms after it. So we just arbitrarily cut it. So on the table you will see that we have not quite half of what was up, well, it was in the ground, and the rest of it's still in the ground to be divided. But that was an interesting experience. Okay, so there are some plants that you do not want to divide, and these are things you might not consider. Things that resent moving are butterfly weed, which is the native plant, but it has a very long taproot. The euphorbias, oriental poppies, baby's breath, gas plant, Japanese anemones. We have divided Japanese anemones, but they do resent it. They get a little cranky about that. So baptisia and columbines. Those plants is best to transplant seedlings, which are, they're prolific seeders, many of them. So if you just look in the spring to see where some seedlings are coming up, and then transplant those instead of trying to go with the, or you can plant seeds. Butterfly milkweed grows very well from the seeds. Christmas and Lenten roses are difficult to move when they are more than a few years old. And again, oh, here's a picture. So again, you want to transplant seedlings. So this spring we had a number of nice little seedlings on our hellebores, and we repotted those. Just dig them up. Right here I used this. I dug them up and got probably all the roots, and then just repotted at the same level it was growing. More plants that you should just leave alone. Don't try to divide these small woody shrubs, lavender cotton, which is Santalina, that's this. perennial candy tuft, lavender, rosemary. I have tried to divide rosemary. That doesn't work. Russian sage and several of the artemisias, any woody artemisias don't work. So those are candidate. Those are all candidates for ground layering, which is another form of clonal reproduction. And this is a picture of, this is actually a hydrangea, but it gives a good example of what you do here. You basically wound the bottom side of a branch. Sometimes these just do this without any encouragement. So if you have a big rosemary plant, you actually may find some ground layered sections underneath. Check for roots, and then you're going to cut it off from the mother plant, and then if it has a good root system, you can transplant that rather than try to take a, try to divide it. And that's all I have for the slideshow. So we're going to move over to the table here and show you a little bit what I've been talking about. We were going to do this outside, but I thought that with the wind and the crowd and what?
And the noise.
And the noise, the wind noise, yeah. Yeah, I did want to show them. These are the crinums. I don't know if you saw these. This is what we dug up from the garden yesterday and today. And you can see, I'm just going to show you this. This is the damage we did. And so we're not sure what's going to happen to the ones that we sliced. But we got a lot of healthy ones, so they may be a sacrificial lamb. We'll try planting them, see what happens.
And I want to mention, too, that I once took one that was big as a football and put it in a pot and left it outside during the winter. It will not make it. They need to be in the ground. Now, the people in South Carolina are fine because their weather's a little bit better. But that's my experience with them. So I would say plant them where you want them.
Yeah, and divide, if you want to divide them more frequently than every 7 years.
How old is that clump?
7 years. And this is only part of the clump. The rest of it's still outside. So
I got one this spring or last, whenever you have this sale.
Uh-huh.
And I looked at it, and it looks like it's started growing.
About now.
About now.
So you can see this had started coming up when it was warm. And you can see that the frost did a lot of damage to it, but this, we can just cut this off, and they're coming out nice and nice, lots of nice new green, and it'll be fine.
It may not bloom the first year. Sometimes it takes longer.
Yeah. Okay. Well, since while we're at it, might as well, right? Yeah, we might as well wrestle one out. See what that looks like. Look at that. This one's white. So, yeah, that picture that was on that slide was this one. So that's what you do. And there were, this one had some roots cut off. But there, it's amazing how, listen to that.
And if you cut them real, real, you know, you cut into the bulb, it may not leave.
We'll see.
We'll see, but a lot of times they don't.
Okay, here's a nice smaller one. Mm-hmm. Probably a little bit easier to handle.
Did you cut the leaves off of yours in this fall?
Well, they die down.
Yeah. I never cut
there you go.
Like
there you go. Monster.
Now this little one that's been chopped half in two, its days are probably numbered.
Well, that was, we didn't have three strong men to help me out, so we only had one. There was Mark and me, so we did what we could. We did what we could. Plant sacrifice. Let's move these off so Sharon can demonstrate the iris. So
Chris will probably get me to tell this, but I was out in the carport this morning. It was pouring down the rain. I had a 3-year-old grandson out there with me, and I looked, and he was out in the rain with his hands like this. I love the rain. your iris are just beginning to bloom, and this is a tall bearded. This is the first bloom I've had on that, and they're about 2 weeks early this year if you're into iris.
Mm-hmm.
And if I were growing this in my garden and it looked like this, I probably would leave it alone because I don't think that's all that big. But if I decided I wanted to replant it or to share it with someone, I would break the rhizomes off. And you don't hear too much about this, but I was told I was a member of the Irish Society for a number of years, and we were told that when you replant, to take this and soak it in 10% Clorox in a gallon of water and let it soak for 3 or 4 hours, then let it just lay somewhere and dry out for 3 or 4 days. And I think that has a lot to do with you don't want to use a lot of wet or soft tissue or anything, and that, you know, it sort of gives it a chance to dry. If you've got a lot though, like some of us, that's a lot to do, but that was one of the recommendations when I was in the Irish Society. And if I were replanting this, I would not take the little babies off the back because I think they're very healthy looking. And I would cut my foliage back 6 or 7 inches. I was told to cut it like a teepee, and I don't know exactly why that is, but that's just in my training. And I would probably cut most of these roots off because they're just going to be in the way. And it's recommended that you take, see, I break this off and get rid of it. And this is why it needs soaking, because that could just be opening up to insects or different things. Three or four days. At my house, I have a clothesline, but I know most of you don't. I hang them on the clothesline with a clothespin.
You don't use clothes
anymore. I don't use them too much anyway. Okay, now what I've got now is about three divisions. And I would plant these where they're facing each other in a little circle. And they need to be on top of the ground, excuse me. So they can take a sunbath. Okay, any other questions about the iris?
Would you get the formula for the soaking in the Clorox again?
10% solution.
10%. Sharon?
Yes.
Does it matter if you, do you need to soak them before you cut the leaves off and trim the roots, or?
I do. That's just, you know, you can just put more in there. I think you could do it either way, but I think cutting them would make more sense.
Before you put them in there?
Yes.
And you cover the leaves also, not just the rhizome?
I would cover the rhizome with about 1 inch of soil.
No, I'm talking about when you soak it. You're soaking the leaves.
Oh, it doesn't matter about the leaves. I just put the whole thing in a bucket of water.
Okay. And you put just a touch of dirt across the top of the rhizomes, or do you put any when you're planting it?
I put about an inch just so it'll make it be able to stay in the ground.
Okay.
It's going to come out of the soil anyway. It's going to come up on top because they like to let it take a sunbath.
Yeah, I'm going to do that.
Okay. And we'll move on.
Just want to do a daylily?
I'll do a daylily. Now you have some daylilies. I know everybody here knows Stella Dior, because that's been on the, you know, probably one of the more popular ones. For something like this, you actually can just wiggle it and jiggle it and make it come apart.
You wouldn't come on this side.
Yeah, I will.
Here we go.
I thought I was calling
that. Oh yeah, let me get my knife.
They are wonderful. And as she said in the top, put about 3 or 4 fans, or at least 2 fans back in the ground.
I don't know if you need it or not.
And you can always use this if you need to. And I always trim back because you're going to have a lot of brown foliage while it's growing back. Hmm. And just put this in the ground.
Now, daylilies you do in the fall because they're summer blooming. Is that correct? Or can you do them now?
I do them in the spring. I think that's best, isn't it?
Spring would be best. Mm-hmm. Fall is okay, too.
Okay.
And a lot of people like to buy them when they're blooming, so of course you've got to plant them then. So it's just a matter of, you know, just don't do it on the really, really hot days.
Specific to the Stella Dior, if you don't divide them, you don't need to divide them. Do they fail to bloom as well if you don't divide them?
Well, I'm going to tell you my opinion about Stella Dior, that North Carolina climate is too hot for them, and they're advertised as ever blooming, and they're that's supposed to be from April till November. But in North Carolina, our weather sometimes at 100 degrees is not good for them, and they're not going to do well.
So does dividing help that, or not? I mean, can you not divide them?
That won't make any difference. Okay. Some years they're going to do well for you, other years you're going to say what happened. It's just Stella.
What about the other day, Lily?
Well, you know, they're 80,000. They all have their own little individual characteristics, and some are vigorous and some are not, and they're all kinds of colors and sizes, and we're going to have a class on that in June, and I'll try to explain more about that.
Yeah, learn more about it and sign up for Think Green Thursdays on, is it June 6th? Or what
15th,
is it? June 15th, okay. To pick up a Think Green Thursday flyer on your, if you don't have one, pick one up on the way out. Day lilies? I think it's called One Day Wonders.
Okay.
And here's a big clump that we dug today.
Do you know the name of it?
Jen Mellon.
Okay. Jen's one of the better ones on the
That's my
market.
Favorite.
And these will be for sale at plant sale. So if you don't have any and you want to grow just one great one, this is a great one. But when your daylilies get this big and you have more than 17 of those stakes coming out of them, it's time to divide. Because they won't bloom as well.
What is the name of
that? This is Jen Mellon. And Jen Mellon has proliferation, which is, you know, you can plant that and make another plant. So it's got a lot of good vigor, and it's got good characteristics. Okay, now they do make a daylily divider that I've seen within the last year. I tried to borrow one from a friend in Greensboro, but I don't live close to there, so I couldn't get it back to her before she needed to use it, so I have chosen to use these. But anyway, I'll show you a picture of what that daylily divider looks like when we do the program in June. Okay.
You believe this?
We're going to use, because I have had talks where I told people to put two forks together, and they thought I was talking about those things you eat with. Figured that out, then we started using the tools. And you just put it down in there. Oh, you got a big clump.
It's a big clump.
Back to back. And all you do after that is pull it apart.
Look at that. Easy peasy.
So you don't have to spend $50 for the new tool when this one works just as well.
You can have two forks.
Right, well, you have to have two.
Can you buy this one again? Or no?
Probably. You could divide it. You know, you still want to have your two or three fans together to have a plant that'll do well. Put it back in there, back to back, and pull it.
How about that? You have to plant that one with the fork. Awesome.
Okay, there you go. Other questions about the daylilies?
Now, is that about the size that you want to put in the ground?
That's about
this one would be my size.
Okay.
So we could divide that again.
I would divide that again.
Yeah. It works well.
Mm-hmm. And as I said, they will not bloom as well if they're in huge clumps.
Okay.
Okay.
Do we want to show pot, putting something in a pot?
If they want to see it, we want a pot.
You want to see something potted up? See us pot something up? Let's take one of these things. No, that was cut.
Here's a question.
Sure. Yes.
Have you ever done the Solomon seal? Have you ever, or you just dig it up? My friends have had, do you just dig another spot, but you really don't.
I don't move it to another spot, but I do dig it up.
Yeah.
Because it you know, I've got it on the back of one of my flower beds, and it just sort of spreads and goes and goes and goes.
Yes, it does.
And if anybody comes by my house and they like it, they have their home with it.
Yes.
I started off with one little plant several years ago, and I would have never thought it would have multiplied this way.
Let's do this one. I was going to do one of the big ones.
That's good.
And that should fit in one. That might fit in one of these.
What is the name of that plant you were just talking about in the base?
Solomon seal.
This? Solomon seal, yes. Makes a nice cut flower, too.
I was going to say, flower arrangements, it's good.
It is the best.
It's a great plant.
Either one. You can't kill it.
No, don't make it a challenge, Sharon.
Even dogs don't hurt it.
Nothing hurts it.
I gave it to my daughter.
Nothing hurts
and
it.
Her dog.
You need to leave about an inch of space at the top of your container. But I told you earlier, my experience with these in a pot was not good.
Well, we're just gonna.
If you have a sale like we're having in
September,
great way to move them.
So we'll hold some of these until September in pots.
Okay, you didn't pot all the way down, so I'm assuming this doesn't get planted at the same height that you took it out of the ground. Am I making sense?
When I went to the garden last summer, the lady had it planted up on top of the ground.
Oh, okay.
And I asked her why she was doing that, and she said, I thought that was the way I was supposed to do it. But I told it would live if she put it on.
I think
you want to plant it a little deeper than that. He was showing it like here.
That's what I'm getting at, because that looked like you were digging it up almost where the green is.
Right.
But we tried to be very careful about giving advice to people when they're not asking for it.
So true. So yeah, that's how you would plant it. And this needs a bigger pot.
Yeah, I didn't bring a big enough pot for that.
It needs a bigger pot because these are big.
If you're buying one of these at the plant sale for $5, that is a bargain.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You won't find them much less than 12 at the nursery.
So yeah.
Yeah, shipping a 12 more.
What is it called again?
Crinums.
Crinum.
Some people say crinum lilies.
How do you spell that?
C-R-I-N-U-M. Yeah, everybody needs to go at least one, but as I said, put it where you want to keep it forever and enjoy it. Because they bloom in kind of in the late June when nothing else is blooming and your eyes will go to it. And they're all colors like white and pink and red and strong. They're real attractive.
Do we want to pot up a daylily while we're at it?
We can, but I would cut it off the top first.
Cut off the top.
Do we still sell those?
No, we never sold them. They were your. All right. So how short?
I would go taller, up higher.
Here?
Yeah.
Okay. Always learning.
Six or seven.
Okay, thanks. I'm gonna go home and be busy. Yeah. I'll get that one off because it's ugly. That one's ugly. It's coming off. That one's ugly too. So I'm taking off some of the dead leaves and the ugly leaves.
Think the root system is healthy looking?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I didn't hear. I missed a spot.
Can we get you when we divide the daylilies?
Sure. You bet.
Get out all these brown roots. Clean it up. And a lot of people wash their daylilies because if this were growing outside and there were weeds growing in it, course, you're planting your weeds. So a lot of people will take these and wash all the soil off before they do anything with it. And if you're buying from nurseries or from gardeners that sell them, I would recommend you doing the same thing. So we grow every weed that there is.
Is that true for any of these that we're providing? Would you just wash the dirt off of it?
Well, actually, if you're doing the mail order like you talked about, they are required to wash the plants. So if you bought them locally, you probably would be okay, because you're expected to do that. Okay, there again, leave about an inch. And these will be for sale at our plant sale. $5 is a bargain. Because we give pretty good pumps.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are.
Okay.
Could you do one of the irises? Okay.
Oh, plant one?
Mm-hmm.
What'd you?
Sometimes you put them in pots because you might want to give them to a friend.
Where'd they go? Oh. Well, these, here's some. Now, where are the ones you cut? We buried them. They're totally buried.
Yeah, they are. Probably just do this if I were possible. Can I just take it?
We have a plant sale. It's September 10th.
I think it's the 21st. It's the 21st.
That's in the Presbyterian Church.
That's the herb.
September 20th, okay.
Yeah,
I thought we were going to sell the daylilies at the daylily class.
Master Gardeners Grow. All the plants are $5, although looking at those crinum bulbs, we might have to charge them.
And I have a correction. We're going to have a class on daylilies in June, and we're going to sell daylilies after the class.
Oh,
not before, because they might get daylily and go home.
That's, you must stay and watch.
More than an inch in this, because you're not going to leave it in here forever anyway.
Right.
And then the plant itself will push up. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Sometimes I found when you do contain a growing with the iris, you have to put a little fertilizer in there too, because they just keep shrinking and shrinking. Instead of getting bigger like you would think, they shrink. So you have to watch the fertilization a little bit.
Hmm.
With some of these plants that you have here, do you have any problems with deer?
Mm-hmm. Not at my house, and that's strange because I live in the country.
They're all at my house.
I never. They're all in the city.
Apparently, they're at my house, and it's in town. But
and I can't explain it. I don't know why.
I don't know if they eat crinums or not, but I know they eat daylilies and hostas. So.
They love hostas.
But not hellebores.
And what about the Solomon?
I don't think they bother those either. So. That works?
Well, I'll let you know. That's my new plan. I put my hostas in the middle of my
okay. All right. Well, I guess that's the class. And thank you for coming today and putting up with us being inside.
Yeah, we were planning to do this outside.
You know, you might tell them about the Elements Gardener newsletter that we put
out. Right. And then we do have the Elements Gardener newsletter, which is put out monthly. It's an e-newsletter which comes to your inbox. If you're not a subscriber, it's free and it has garden tips monthly. Jim Beasley, one of our master gardeners, is demonstrating.
We have gardening classes, usually about two per month. So I think Green Thursday's class schedule, all different kinds of gardening topics. So we've done pruning. We'll have a class on vegetable gardening. We'll have a class on birds. We have a rain garden class, drought tolerant plants, fall lawn care. It's quite a long list of gardening classes we provide to the public to give them a better understanding of different gardening topics. All our classes are free, and they're held at 10 o'clock on Thursday morning here in the Ag Building.